Hi, this is Annie Dance. I'm an independent investigative journalist working to shine a light on police and policy issues in Rutherford County, Western North Carolina, and beyond. Please subscribe if you haven't already to anniedance.substack.com, my Cops in Congress newsletter, and follow me on social media at Twitter, X at Annie M Dance, also on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube. And I'm also on TikTok, but I tend to use Facebook and Twitter the most. So you may have seen my recent story about increased crime on the Thermal Belt Rail Trail. And I want to highlight a few things. But first, when you go to anniedance.substack.com, you can click on subscribe and you can type your email in here, and then you can choose your subscription level. The lowest tier subscription right now is $15 a month, and that will show you all that is offered to you, including the full archive of all my previous paid stories. And of course, my utmost thanks for your support as I work to continue to shine a light on these important issues. If you choose not to become a paid subscriber, I understand. However, you will not get access to any scoops or exclusive stories that I mark as paid. For example, the scoop that I offered and reported on June 3rd. So, more on that in a second. But first, let me share my latest story about the Thermal Belt Rail Trail I published on June 4th, which included video that I highly recommend you taking a look at to get a full, accurate historical portrayal of the facts and of all of the crimes that have happened. So I will just briefly note, I did speak with Jerry Stensland, executive director of the nonprofit Rutherford Outdoor Coalition, on Friday evening at the Rutherfordton Fab Festival, and he gave me some interesting insights. So we're amicable, and there's no, certainly no ill will on my end towards anyone who questions my work. I understand his perspective. However, I report facts. I do question everything. And I spoke to the county commissioners last Monday, 1 week ago, to encourage them to have more public safety measures, including possibly surveillance cameras, on increased police patrols, specifically to the Thermal Belt Rail Trail, but really in any public space that the county manages. So more on that to come, but today I want to share with you more information about specifically about a recent incident. So I scooped this story on June 3rd is when I published it. However, on the Friday prior to that was this incident. Convicted felon was arrested after assault reported on Thermal Belt Rail Trail Forest City PD documents show. Police said the incident happened Friday morning. Public records show Stephen Sprouse, 35, has a lengthy criminal history, plus Cops in Congress commentary about past incidents and trail safety. So read that. And again, this is a paid story. So because it took me a lot many hours to get all of those public records requests together and to fully report on this event. However, today I am going to share in a manner of really public interest, and to springboard off of the incident. I think it's important to also get the victim's perspective when victims are willing to speak with me. So I did speak with the victim in this case, and here are his insights, word for word.
To your time reporting this, so I don't misquote you inaccurately. So fill us in. What happened? Can you elaborate what happened to you on the trail on Friday?
Off the Heritage Valley, and I walked the rail trail every morning with my dog. And I'm going towards RV, all of the directions, up near the bridge. I guess across the bridge, right there where the crosswalk is, where Scott is, and there's a black face mask that's laying on the ground that somebody had, I guess, had dropped. And I see him coming towards me on a bike. And I mean, I could spot these people from a mile away because I just see them. I know exactly, you know, they're whatever. So the black face mask was on the ground, and I took my left foot and I kicked it out of the way to the side off the trail onto the gravel. And as he's coming up, he's saying something to me, and I couldn't understand what he was saying. And the closer he got, he was like, "Why did you kick that effing dog?" And I was like, "What?" He was like, "I saw you kick that effing dog." I was like, "Dude, you're out of your mind. You have no idea what you're talking about." I was like, "I would never kick my dog." He's like, "Yeah, I saw you kick that dog." And I was like, "Look, dude," I was like, "you need to take yourself home and go somewhere." I was like, "Mind your business." I was like, "I would never do that. F you, I saw you kicking that effing dog," and then all of a sudden he pulls a knife out of his pocket. And I was like, "All right, fine." So I called 911, and as I'm on the phone with 911, he decides, I guess, that he's in the right, and he's just there and waits for them to get there. And so they get there, which, I mean, I can't tell you the exact amount of time it took, but it did take a minute for them to get there. I mean, it seemed to, you know, come to me with that knife. I mean, we were just up on the ground before they did. It should be taken away from them. Come up, and they, you know, they arrested them, and the officer said, "Something happened," and I told him exactly what I just told you, and he asked for his name, a number, and an address, for me to put my ID on me outside the house. And so they had a description with, and they were taking him in, and so I had to go to court. So they were praying, before I was like, "I'm going to be in the middle," that's where I was helping. So I don't know if that's going to happen, but this is an event here, and I'm going to for the video for the walk trail every single morning. And between the homeless, the addicts that are especially in that stretch of rail trail, and the stray dogs that are always approaching, like, it's just unsafe. And people walk there in the morning. And I know for a fact that they have all ATV vehicles to patrol these rail trails. And in the year and a half that I've been here, I've seen them one time.
Mm-hmm.
And then in that next morning, I did see an officer patrolling the area of the side of the street that where all that happened at that next morning. But then, you know, these following mornings that I've gone involved and everything, I haven't seen, you know, mm-hmm. had nor have calls of an officer patrolling or anything like that. I understand that resources are, you know, what their resources are or whatever. But at the same time, like, this is a public access trail. I mean, there's a house right down the street from me where their dog's off the leash all the time. He's always up and down the rail trail. You know, he's a bad dog, but at the same time, it's unacceptable.
Right.
So, it's just, you know, it's very caring chamber. It's something to do. I mean, so,
well, thank you for sharing that. Do you feel the need? I mean, I know concealed carry holder permit holders are authorized to carry on the trail according to the trail rules. Is that something you're considering or you want to do as well?
Well, I don't have a concealed carry permit, but I do have a but yes, I mean, that incident has triggered me to go ahead and go get so very just so I can make sure that
was
right between those right out and I was right off the stage. And had a little bit of two different members of our team. You know, it's just it's ridiculous. And playing, you know, certainly, you know, playing really it's working players to be able to feel safe in this different brain.
Right. No, I certainly agree. Just to give you a little more background on me, I actually usually typically do the northern section, like Grand Ruth, but it's an issue along the whole trail, unfortunately. So what I'm looking into, and what's really eye-opening to me in a lot of ways, for the police department are a lot more transparent in their reports. So I actually saw the Thermalvolt Rail Trail on their app. So I saw the incident first on their app on Friday, and then went from, you know, dove in from there to get the report and so on. So I appreciate you sharing your story. Do you have anything else to add? I don't know what you mentioned, some of the patrols. Obviously, Forest City has their own police department. So I spoke at the Rutherford County Commissioners meeting on Monday night to advocate for surveillance cameras and more police patrols, specifically more to that northern section that is covered by them. But they all work in partnership.
And there's such a fine line between what Rutherford County is supposed to be covering, what Forest City is supposed to be covering, because when it comes to things like and things like that, they're like, oh, well, you have to talk to the city police.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't have no jurisdiction. And I'm like, okay, you have to talk to the city police, and they come over and they don't do anything.
Yeah, that's unfortunate to hear.
Here, because there's other things that there's definitely in the neighborhoods. These are things, I mean, I don't know what jurisdiction as far as, you know, the county, city, whatever, but, you know, just trash and garbage and things not being maintained. I mean, you've got people moving into these neighborhoods that, you know, somebody has to really go out there and be from them and rebuild, but then some of them are people that are going to be built by people, and then, you know, if you have a facility that just from church all the way until it's flowing up into the street. So I want to know, when our city council meetings and things like that, also I can start involved in some stuff, because unless somebody starts getting involved or something.
Absolutely. See something, say something. Of course you can go to the Forest City website to see what they have and when those meetings are. I don't have the resources, unfortunately, to cover, you know, every town in the county. I would love to, but as an independent journalist, yeah, I just don't unfortunately have the time to do so. So I'm trying to cover the county and go from there. I live in Green Hill, so the county affects what they do and don't do affect me directly. But absolutely, I concur with everything that you mentioned. So I greatly appreciate your willingness to speak with me, and I'll be updating the story. I'll probably end up sharing part of our audio to my YouTube page and do an update, because part of what I do, I have a mixture of free and paid stories for subscribers. So for all these public records, you know, it takes a considerable amount of time for me to pull these public records together, but so those are things that, you know, I ask for subscribers, paid subscribers only. But if and you know, something like my conversation with you today is more in the public interest, so I'll probably do that as a free story, because it needs to be, you know, it's a story that needs to be told, and there's so many, I feel like there's so many things that are happening that are going untold. So I greatly appreciate that.
Getting things on. Or just to the wrong police, like the thing, and like I said, you know, coming to call for the police, I respect the police and I want the police. And, you know, at the same time, when you have the resources to what they deserve to go,
it's just fine.
I thought a job I did on a 10 page or a 3 page that they're trying to find was someone who be a civilian. One of the things I've heard that they want to take as well. I think it's like $70 an hour.
I was just going to mention that to you. I saw that too, yeah.
Yeah, and that's insane to me. So you want to risk my life $15 an hour for $20 or $20 a week. Like, that doesn't make sense. So, that's definitely safe.
Right. It's just wild. It really is.
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't think these are things that I've gotten, stuck by the way, fine, because there's also a connection with people that are considered like really, it's in her.
Agree, absolutely. I think that's spot on. Where did you move from, if you don't mind me asking? Just...
I moved from Nashville, but I'm originally from Charlotte, born and raised, but I lived in Nashville for the past 10 years.
That's interesting. So you've seen it all, and you know, within the area of how crime is. Do you feel from what you've seen and heard, do you feel like crime is has increased over the years?
Absolutely.
Very interesting. Well, thank you so much for talking with me, Stephen. Feel free to reach out. Thank you. I will. Take care.
All right.
Well, there you have it, word for word from Stephen Turner, the assault victim in the alleged assault by Stephen Sprouse on the Thornbelt Rail Trail in Forest City. Stephen Turner had some really interesting insights, I found, especially to his point of, you know, he had this directly affect him, and he's undeterred and still loves the area and still walks on the trail. So, you know, this is factual information about crime happening in our community. And to his point is that people are moving here from different states and different areas. And there's an extra expectation that's needing to be met now, and it's not going to. And he said, quote, "What's going to happen is something really, really bad's going to happen, and it's not going to be good," unquote. So I really hope leaders take that to heart, and you have just the situational awareness to know what's going on around you. So I dove into these details in my story, but I just wanted to highlight some public records that are more easily accessible that anyone can access. If you go to North Carolina Judicial Branch's website, there's e-courts, which are underway. That's a whole other story that I will be covering in the coming months when Rutherford County comes online. They're not scheduled to anytime soon. So there's a few different ways you can do it. You can either sort by county, or let's say you want to look up somebody and you're not sure if they have charges in other jurisdictions, like, for example, Stephen Sprouse. I wasn't sure. So let's look up Stephen Sprouse with a B. And my N button on my laptop isn't working very well. So, okay, so Stephen Sprouse right now, he has three separate cases, according to North Carolina Judicial Branch's website. And I'm bringing this up for a few reasons. First, I mentioned earlier, he has a lengthy criminal history, but these are pending charges. So I'm going to go back to this in a second, but let's look at the state offender public information search offender locator tool. So same thing, we can look up his name. I know his middle initial. There's other parameters you can look up too. His birthday is January 18th, 1989. This is all public information. It doesn't list his photo. However, if you scroll back, so he's 35, right? And his middle name is misspelled in several instances. My understanding is the correct spelling is just one K. So according to state records, you can see that his charges go back years. He's escaped from prison. Okay. Yes. Why? And his charges go back years. He's also a convicted sex offender, according to North Carolina State Bureau of Investigation records. Again, this is public information. You can look for yourself online of all of those charges. But going back to his state prison record, it appears that he failed to notify for his address change as a sex offender. Detention center records show that he's homeless. And as you heard from the victim in this case, that he apparently came out of the woods on a bicycle. And in that situation, but going back and looking at the history, he has been charged in over 25 cases, plus the additional charges related to this case. And then on the 26th, he was arrested again on multiple charges. According to this, he is due in court today on June 10th. I read that earlier in another screen, but these latest charges include felony possession of a Schedule II controlled substance. Again, he has multiple charges, and crime is happening in this community. I don't know how else to make it plain to everyone, including officials who are in charge of public safety of our community. The Thermal Belt Rail Trail's community partners include RHI Legacy Foundation, the Town of Forest City, the Town of Rutherfordton, Town of Spindale, Rutherford County, Rutherford Outdoor Coalition, Community Health Council, the Tourism Development Authority, and Rutherford Chamber of Commerce and Betjeman Site Historic Park. It is actually governed, and how it's set up is very interesting because it is overseen. The oversight is by the Rutherford Rail Development Corporation, RRDC. The president of that is Rutherfordton Town Manager Doug Barrick. So when there's incidents that happen on the trail, you can see on the trail info on their website the rules, including safety. So in the trail rules, it says that firearms and other weapons are prohibited, but concealed carry permit holders under the law are allowed, and so on. It does say that for emergencies, call or text 911, include your location nearest cross street, and the hours are open dawn to dusk. So just to reiterate, the length, it's a little difficult to see here, but basically north of Ruth, my understanding is that is the jurisdiction falls to Rutherford County. And of course, Rutherfordton is in Rutherfordton city limits, Spindale city limits, and Forest City is Forest city limits. So that gives you hopefully a better geographical understanding of who is responsible for what. But of course, it's a beautiful trail. I was going to go for a bike ride, but now it's getting pretty cloudy out. It might rain. So it's a beautiful trail. I use it personally, frequently, and it's great for Rutherford County. But here's a better map that will hopefully give us a better picture. Here we go. So if you zoom in here, from Gilkey to Ruth is Rutherford County, to just give you a better geographic sense of things. And it's over 13 miles long. Again, please subscribe to anniedance.substack.com, where I scoop the latest crime and report the facts. And of course, throw in that Cops and Conkers commentary. Thanks for watching. See you next time.